Sometimes I feel like giving up. It seems like my best just ain't good enough. Lord, if you hear me, I'm calling you. Do you see, do you care all about what I'm going through? And then he said, one more day, one more step. See, I'm preparing you for myself. And when you can't hear my voice, please trust my plan. I'm the Lord, I see, and yes, I understand. But sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. I'm just like a stranger so far from home. I feel like I've done all that I can do. Please, Lord, give me strength. I'm just trying to make it through. That's when he told me.
Good afternoon and welcome to Moments of Hope with yours truly, Pastor Curtis Robert Grant, the Zion Hope Missionary Baptist Church. For those of you that are with us today, we are so glad that you have chimed in with us and hoping all is well with you and your family. Those of you that are going to join with us in the conference call, you can dial 515-606-5380 and then the access code is 636-090. God bless you and keep you is our prayer. I hope you have brought your Bibles with you so that we can read through scriptures and we try to go through. And I'm hoping you are reading ahead of time or at least going after the presentation and read again so that you don't have to trust nothing I say. You can kind of read the Bible for yourself, comprehend for yourself so that God can continue to reveal himself to all of us that we might continue to walk in the ways of God. And so we're in Genesis chapter 32, starting with verses 1. And I want to read a few of the following verses, and hopefully we'll be able to grab some kind of a comprehension and some relativity for our lives as we go forward. Starting with verse 1. And Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, "This is God's host." And he named, and he called the name of that place, Mahanaim. And Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau, his brothers, unto the land of Seir, unto the country of Edom. And he commanded them, saying, thus shall ye speak unto my lord Esau. The servant Jacob saith, thus, I have sojourned with Laban and stayed there until now. And I have oxen and asses, flocks and manservants and women servants, and I have sent to tell my lord that I may find grace in thy sight. And the messengers returned to Jacob, saying, we came to thy brother Esau, and also he cometh to meet thee, and 400 men with him. And Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed, and he divided the people that was with him, and the flock and the herd and the camels into two bands. And he said, if Esau come to the one company and smite it, then the other company which is left shall escape. And that is the reading of our text today. And I just want to kind of deal with some things and hopefully we'll be able to grasp this journey and understand the relativity of these things to our own personal life. Here again, we see Jacob. He's now on his way to the land where his mother and his father were still dwelling along with Esau. And so we see that he is now on his way back to Canaan. And I want you to understand, brothers and sisters, that the last thing that we had the privilege of seeing is that Laban and Jacob had come into a covenant where they had agreed that if one of the other would cross the point by which they have set up the designated area, that one had the authority to kill the other one if we broke the covenant. And what you actually see at this particular point is that God does this for Jacob, and he does it for all of us, is he literally closes the door behind Jacob. Now, I want you to get this vision in your head so that you can see it. Because if where Jacob is heading is the promised land, Canaan, then where he's come from is literally the world. And so when you look at it, you find out that now Jacob is coming out of the world and he's headed to the promised land. And what God does for Jacob is he closes the door to the fact that Jacob can no longer go back to the world. And so the first thing I think we all need to comprehend is that once we make up our mind to seek after God and the kingdom of God, God closes the door behind us because he wants to take away the option that once we make up our mind to seek after him, there is no more going back to the world. And I've had disappointment with people who have literally gone back to the world, or they no longer want to pursue God. And saints, those individuals, you have to understand that even though they were in the crowd, they were still not a disciple. And see, you have to understand the difference between being a disciple and being in the crowd, because the crowd is not connected to Jesus. They're just there to eat the fish and the fish sandwich and to see the miracles. But the disciples are those of the individuals that are not there to just eat the sandwich and see the miracles. They're there to try to learn what the principles of this following was really all about. And so when you see people that actually have the privilege of turning back, it's only because they were part of the crowd and they never became a disciple. When you become a disciple, God closes the door so that there is no option for you to go back to the world. And so at the end of the day, you have to monitor your position in God, because just because you go to church every day don't mean that you are a disciple. Just because you go and you give and you do what you're supposed to do in church don't mean that you're a disciple. Because when you define the word disciple, it means student, it means a pupil, it means the individual that takes time to study why he follows Christ, the principles by which Christ gives for us to follow. And those are the individuals who have literally made up their minds not to go back to the world, because, hello, when you understand Jesus and understand who he is and all the promises that he gives, the world is not even an option to us anymore, because what God has put in our future is so much greater than what we've left in our past. And so therefore, brothers and sisters, when you see transitions happen like that, you've got to ask yourself, were they ever true disciples in the first place? Were they ever true followers of Christ? Because when people can go back to God, and what I mean by that, because to reject God and say you don't want to follow God or Jesus anymore is literally to say go back to the world, because ain't but two places. You either follow God or you follow the world. Because at the end of the day, everything else is what the devil has put out there for you to be deceived by. And Christ is the only way, according to the word of God, for us to get back to God. And so with that being said, closed doors is how God uses to cut off opportunities that he don't want us to ever experience. And saints, I pause for the moment and talk about closed doors, because we have allowed closed doors to become our disappointment. And you've got to understand that when you seek after God, God in his infinite wisdom uses closed doors to direct the life of the believer. Because sometimes when you are not clear about the will of God, God will close the door so that it is no longer an option for you, so that you don't have to find yourself in a place where the will of God won't keep you. And so you got to understand that closed doors are just God's way of directing your life. And don't get so upset, about the opportunities that you missed because of closed doors, because it's only an indication that that's not where God wanted you to be. Because when God closes a door, he closes it for your good so that he can keep you on the path in which he needs you to travel. I think the scripture goes on and says, God closes doors that no man can open. He opens doors that no man can close. And therefore, he deals with us with open and closed doors. And so if you have a closed door, don't get disappointed. Move to the next door, because the next door just might be your door so that God can continue to move your life in the right direction. He put a closed door behind Jacob because he wants to take away from Jacob, watch this, the opportunity to turn back. Because at the end of the day, he needs reconciliation to happen in the life of Jacob and Esau in order for things to continue forward. And so therefore, God closes the door for Jacob so that he can never go back to where he came from. And it's interesting now that he's on his way, according to chapter 32, and he runs into angels, the Bible says. Now, this word Mahanaim actually means two armies. It means two camps. In other words, it wants to submit that there were two camps of angels that literally met Jacob. And I want you to see this, because it's interesting that chapter 32 opens up with this, and you got to see that God, first of all, wants to show Jacob that I'm with you, all right? And then number two, he wants to show Jacob, I got your back. I'm the one that's going to protect you. And saints, notice that he did not send one band of angels. He literally sends two. And because God is anticipating what Jacob is going to encounter when the message comes back from his brother Esau. You don't hear it, but let me see if I can paint the picture for you. Because Esau, according to the scripture, the messenger came back to Jacob and said, your brother is going to meet you, but he's going to meet you with 400 men. And see, the Bible says that when he heard that, he was automatically in fear. He was distressed because his brother was coming to meet him and he had 400 men. And the only thing that could play in Jacob's head was his brother was coming back for revenge. But what he failed to remember is that just as many people as with Esau was with Jacob, because God showed Jacob up front that I got two bands of angels surrounding you, and don't matter what comes from Esau, I got you. I got your back. And saints, that's what I want to tell you today, is that when God closes a door, he not only closes the door so that you don't return, he gives you what you need in order for you to go forward. And you've got to believe that when God closes a door for you to go forward, he will give you everything you need in order for you to move and not be disturbed by your moving forward in God. Because when God gives you angels, ministering angels, sometimes they manifest themselves in spiritual bodies, and sometimes they manifest themselves in physical bodies, because God can use men to be your angels at times, because all the word angel simply means is messenger. And so sometimes God used both angelic bodies and he used human bodies. But whatever you have to see, know that God is always going to give you what you need to move forward. And so therefore, he gives to Jacob angels, two bands of angels, to let him know that no matter how many people Esau bring with him, they will never be able to overpower you. And that's what I come to tell some of y'all today, that even though you see what's in front of you, know that God has ministering angels around you, that no matter what comes against you, it will not be able to overpower you. Because when God wants you to go forward, tell me what force can stop you from moving forward when God is for you. And that's all I'm trying to get you to understand in the midst of this closed door issue. Because when God closes a door, he's not trying to trap you. He's trying to keep you from going back to the places where he's delivered you from. Therefore, I say to you, go forward in the power of God. And God has already sent his angels before you to make successful your way. And you've got to trust God, even though you don't see your angels, because you don't know who they are, and sometimes you entertain them unaware. You don't even know that God has sent people to you to give you insight, download spiritual insight into your spirit just to get you where you are supposed to go. And I didn't mean to get excited about all that stuff, but I'm hoping you can understand what I'm coming to. And so the Bible wants to submit that Jacob now sends a message to his brother Esau. And what he says to Esau, which was very keen to me, was he kept saying, Lord. He kept calling his brother Lord. And Lord indicates that Esau was greater than Jacob. In other words, Jacob humbled himself in the presence of his brothers. Because the truth of it is, if you really go back and look at it, Esau was not the one that got the birthright. It was Jacob. Jacob was the one that got the birthright. So in this situation, it should have been Jacob that was superior. Because the one that gets the birthright is the one that's in charge of the family. But Jacob, even in all that he had gathered and all that God has blessed him with, humbled himself in the presence of his brothers. Because at the end of the day, he was not coming to gloat in front of his brothers. He was not coming to pump his chest out like, look at what the Lord has done for me. No, he was coming to reconcile to his brother. And in order to do that, he had to humble himself in order for his brothers to see that he was not coming in a cocky way. And that's what I probably would say that some of y'all today, that the reason that reconciliation don't happen for a lot of y'all is because y'all don't go with a humble spirit. Most of the people want to come back to brag about, and they come with this not so godly spirit, trying to reconcile with people. And saints, you can't do that. In order to reconcile with folk, you got to humble yourself. You got to put yourself in a position that what you say to yourself is whatever it takes for me to restore this relationship, I'm willing to do it. And most of you have made the statement that I did my part, you know, but the truth of it is that you really haven't, because even though you made the attempt, you did it in the wrong spirit and the wrong attitude. Ain't nobody going to be willing to forgive you while you standing up there looking haughty and all overly confident, you see, because they don't even take your presentation as serious. They don't take you serious until you come back with a humble spirit and seeing that you have humbled yourself and realizing that you're willing to do whatever it takes to restore this relationship, then the individual will take you serious. And saints, I'm telling you, some of you have tried, and you have tried because you tried because you thought and you heard and you've been taught that it is the right thing to do. But when you try, make sure you try in the right spirit. Because when you do anything in the wrong spirit, it ain't gonna work like God designed it. All right? And I'm hoping you hear what I'm trying to say to you, because at the end of the day, Jacob is trying to teach us in this presentation that even though he had the birthright, he had to humble himself before his big brother, because if he's gonna ever reconcile this relationship, he had to show his big brother that he didn't come back cocky and all haughty and all, you know, when his chest stuck out like, you know, he's better than his brother. He humbled himself so that his brothers would be able to see that he ain't coming to gloat in his face. Hello, somebody. I'm hoping you're getting this stuff. And so that's what he keeps calling him Lord. And then on top of that, he sends his brothers gifts. I got to get out of here. My time is running out. He sends his brothers gifts because, saints, let me tell you something. You can say what you want with your mouth, but your mouth don't mean nothing until there's some actions behind it. And this is what Jacob does. He not only shows him a humble disposition by calling him Lord, but then he starts treating him like he's Lord. Y'all don't want to hear what I'm trying to tell you. See, in other words, what Jacob is literally saying in here is that I'm humbling myself because your relationship to me is important. And when something is important to you, you're willing to do whatever it takes, not only verbally, all right, but physically as well. So he sends his brothers, all right, Esau, gifts, because he wants his brothers to understand that what God has blessed me, he's blessed us. Because you are my eldest brother, you're part of my family, and anytime I'm blessed, we're blessed. You understand what I'm trying to tell you? And so, saints, at the end of the day, reconciliation is what is in the sight of Jacob, and God uses this scenario to help Jacob understand, no matter how much fear you fear, going back is never an option. And I'm saying this to you, I don't care how much fear you feel, just know that going back is not an option. You've got to move forward even with the fear you feel. They call it courage. All right? That's what courage is. Moving forward in spite of the fear you feel. All right? And Jacob shows a lot of courage because he was absolutely afraid and he was dismayed and he was shaken by the fact that his brother Esau was not only coming to meet him, but he brought 400 men with him. But turning around was not an option. He had to do what God had ordained him to do, and that was reconcile with his brother, all right, Esau. And so I'm hoping that something has been said to you again to help you, because some of you have experienced closed doors and you have allowed the closed doors to break your heart. But honey, let me tell you something. God's closed doors is just the way that he can direct the life of the believer. And so look at them and know that when God closes a door, then move on. But when God opens a door, you have to be swift to walk through the door. Because at the end of the day, no man can close the doors that God closed, and no man can open the doors that God, No man can close the doors that God opens, and no man can open the doors that God closed. All right, I think I got it right that time. All right, my wife is bowing here and saying, I got it right. Okay, anyway, I must be good, so she said I got it right. And so for those of you that have heard this, I'm hoping you understood the message and you're able to apply this stuff to your life. Because at the end of the day, saints, if we don't apply it to our life, what good is us coming to study the scriptures so that we can really know how to operate when it comes to reconciling and dealing with God and dealing with the things that are confronting us so that we can be better people. And so if you've heard this and you want to give your life to the Lord today, any day is a good day. You give us, inbox us your name and your phone number so that our membership academy can get back with you. And then for those of you that are going to be with us today at 1 o'clock, we're going to be in prayer. The man that prays, family that prays together stays together. Scripture says men should always pray and not faint. I want to submit that if you're praying, you're not fainting. And if you're fainting, it's only because you're not praying. And so we want to continue to pray every day for the Lord's strength in our lives, that we might continue to do the will he's called us to do. Let us pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for this presentation. Use it for your glory. Touch the hearts of your people in a way, oh God, that you be glorified in our lives. God, I pray that you take this weak and feeble attempt to expound upon your word. We pray, Lord, that you stretch out in it, that the words that has been spoken here become relevant to us, that we might see them, embrace them, use them, that we might become better people of the kingdom of God, that people will see your love abiding in us in such a manner that they cannot deny that the Spirit of God rests upon us. Be with us, breathe upon us, and help us to be the best we can be. We'll be careful to give you praise, glory, and honor. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and thank God.